and slowly get the concept that the paper and ink on these pages represents the actual Word of God, and the Word of God is what spoke the worlds into creation. It actually spoke the universe into being. He, Jesus, is the very Word of God, and Paul said, we have the mind of Christ. He also said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And so Jesus, the very expression of God, the Word that went forth of God, was captured on paper, and his words given to us through his prophets so that we could have some marvelous changes in our lives. And so this isn't just a book of good ideas. It's not just a self-help book. It's not just a religious book. It is powerful and capable of creating faith in you, which is what we're talking about today. It is going to hopefully finish up the passage on faith that we started last week, the message on faith. So it's going to go, first of all, to 1 Kings chapter 17. I want to tell you a story. Jesus was always good at teaching, telling stories. I'm a pretty good teacher, I think, but I'm a terrible storyteller. I don't take enough time to do illustrations enough, and I don't do enough time to tell good stories. So I'm going to borrow a story from the Old Testament here, one that certainly speaks about faith. In 1 Kings chapter 17, 17 verse 1 says, "And Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead said to Ahab, 'As the Lord God of Israel lives before whom I stand, there shall not be dew or rain these years except at my word.'" A little background on what was going on there was Israel had been divided into two kingdoms after Solomon. It had been split. They had a civil war. It split in two. Judah and Benjamin in the south and the other 10 tribes of Israel in the north. The south was governed by its line of kings, and the northern kingdom was governed by its line of kings. Well, the northern kingdoms of Israel, by the time it reached King Ahab, had gotten pretty hellish, really. Had been men of God anymore. They were very corrupt. Ahab's wife was a name that maybe you're familiar with, Jezebel. That kind of level of corruption and so forth. And God was not finished with his people, regardless of the government. And I'm not going there this morning, but you see what I'm saying there as well. God deals with his people sometimes separate from the government, but he spoke to the leader. Ahab did the prophet God, did God through the prophet Elijah, and said that there was going to be drought in the land in an effort to bring people, God's people, to a point of desperation that they would be willing to look back to the God of their fathers and say, I've been doing it my own way a while, and this isn't working. We've depended on the government who has led us astray for a while, and it isn't working. King Ahab is not doing it for us. We've got to go back and look to God to be our provision. And so God made it not rain for a period of years, I think 3 years, and spoke through the prophet Elijah and said this was going to be. Now, that's the background for this. Now mind you, Elijah, therefore, was not a very popular person to the king, Ahab. He was not popular with him at all. And so Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead said to Ahab, "As the Lord God of Israel lives before whom I stand, there shall not be dew or rain these years except at my word." In verse 2, "Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, 'Get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan.'" He had to get away because he was not popular, because he was speaking things over Israel that were not pleasant. They were not encouraging to the people. But yet it was the truth from God. And so God said, you know what? I'm going to protect you. You need to get out of town. I want you to go east. I want to go you to cross the Jordan River and go up the brook Cherith, because it's narrow there, it's wooded there, and it's high, it's well-hidden area. And I want you to just hide out up in that area, and I'm going to tell you what to do from there. And so he says in verse 4, "And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded ravens to feed you there." And so he went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning, and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Now, there's something very significant about that. First of all, this is a lesson in faith, is that if you are called to do something for God, and the result of that, or the result of of famine in your life or in your town or in your job or because of layoffs or whatever the situation is, God has promised to take care of you like he has the man of God in Elijah. And he says, don't worry about what I'm going to do. If I call you to cross the street, cross the nation, cross the world to be a missionary for me, or just to be a provider for your family when you've lost your job, I am going to provide a way for you where there seems to be no way. I'm going to tell you where to go and tell you where the water is at. And I want you to go drink from the water that I provide. But there's no food there. But it's okay because I'm going to send birds of the air to come and feed you. They're going to bring bread and meat for breakfast and for dinner. You're on your own for lunch, apparently. But he said, I'm going to bring that for you and you're going to be provided for. Now, let me tell you what's so miraculous about that. First of all, that birds went and grabbed food from who knows where. Somebody's having a picnic somewhere. Somebody's eating outside, and the birds come and grab the food. It's like that table of bread out there. And birds flock in from everywhere, grab it and fly off with it. Chicken wings and hot wings and bread. And I'm like, what? The birds are grabbing all my stuff. Where are they going? Morning and evening, they're delivering it to the prophet in the wilderness, and he ate well because the ravens brought it to him. Now, that's one miracle from God, isn't it? God provides your food. He said that he promised that he would take care of us in that way. But here's the other, why this is such an even greater miracle. It's a greater miracle because ravens are not known for being generous. What are ravens known for besides being black birds? Not friendly, scavengers. Have you ever heard of the term, I have a ravenous appetite? Ravenous comes from ravens. It is when you have a ravenous appetite, it comes from the fact that ravens are hungry. They're like the goldfish in my tank back there, little liars. They act like I never feed them, and they're always like, feed me, feed me, feed me. My grandchildren feel sorry for them. They think I never feed them. Papa, can we feed the fish? They've been fed, but they have a ravenous appetite, and they are not in the mood to share with each other, and certainly not willing to bring it to the man of God and drop it there for him to eat. So God is saying here, not only am I going to take care of you, I'm going to take care of you with the most unlikely source that you can possibly imagine. I'm going to take a selfish lawyer. I'm going to take a selfish insurance claims adjuster. I'm going to take a selfish person of some description, and by the way, I've been an insurance claims adjuster, so nothing against those occupations if you are one. But the point is, I'm going to take someone who is not likely to be the source that would normally provide for you, and I'm going to not only provide for you, but I'm going to do it in a way that shows my power. It's going to come through the hands of the least likely place in the world. It's going to be as if they flew in from heaven. In this case, they did. So God provided for the prophet using ravens, the most unlikely people to share, unlikely birds to share. And so he was fed there. I want to call attention to verse 4. I want to skip back up there. It says, and it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. I have commanded the ravens. Did the ravens comply? Yeah. They're ravenous. They want to do what they want. But God said, I have commanded that they would do this. Now, the ravens may not have had any idea what they were doing. They may not, they're bird brains. They may not have had the concept of God and a mission and all that. All they knew was they felt compelled to make this happen. Because if inanimate objects are subject to the word of the Lord and happen and do miracles because of that, then certainly something that has a pea brain like a raven can also be commanded by God, which he did. He commanded that it be done. And so God can command the blessing in your life as well. And so verse 5 says, and so he went and did according to the word of the Lord. That's important. He did according to the word of the Lord. He didn't pick his own favorite campsite. He didn't pick another stream other than Cherith Brook. He did exactly what God told him to do, and when he did, that's where the ravens were sent. Now, if you decide that you want to do things your way, if God tells you what to do, but you decide, no, I'm going to take things into my own hands, I'm going to take a job that God isn't telling me that I should be doing, I'm going to go in a direction I shouldn't, I'm going to call on my relatives to help supply my need whenever God's clearly telling me he wants me to depend on him, or whatever, then the ravens are going to take the dinner wherever God said to go, and you're going to be stuck hungry. When you depend on your own self, then you're going, then in times of drought and famine, you are not going to have your needs supplied like it will be when God commands the ravens to send them to the place that he said. And so the prophet did according to verse 5. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. And so for he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into Jordan. Now let's skip down to verse 7. And it says, and it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. And God started biting his nails and worrying. What am I going to do now? I've promised that I would let him drink from the brook, and the brook has dried up. No, God doesn't bite his nails. God knew that was going to happen. But what it meant was there are seasons and times in our life when it's time to do something different. God supplied the need there for a time, but God may send you away from the brook Cherith somewhere else, and he will supply your need there. And sometimes we're not willing to go. God has a lesson in our life he wants to teach us, but sometimes we stay put because it's safe. You keep working the same job over and over again because it's safe. You're afraid to quit and go looking for another job because it's safe. And sometimes God wants you to take a leap of faith and walk where he says to walk and trust that he will take care of you and go. Now, conventional wisdom says don't quit one job before you get another. But that's not always true. It is always true that when God tells you to do something, you do it. Now, you need to make sure God told you, okay? Make sure God told you to do things. But if God tells you to do something, you drop everything and you follow. Why? Because it's going to dry up. And sometimes we don't want to follow, so God has to dry up our supply. And so that we're forced to move. Like, God, the brook's dry. Yeah? Okay. Well, how am I going to get something to drink? Well, didn't I tell you to leave? Well, yeah, but what am I going to drink? Well, you're going to have to trust me. Again? But Lord, I like the last way you provided my needs. Do I have to trust you again in a different way now? Does it ever get comfortable walking on water? No, it never feels natural walking on water. Faith is always doing one more new thing God's told you to do by faith, and not depending on doing it the old way. I looked it up, and it says here that he says, or in verse 9, the word of the Lord came to him and said, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. Now, it's interesting there, first of all, in verse 8, it says, the brook dried up in verse 7. In verse 8, it says, then, everybody say then. Then and only then, the word of the Lord came to him. God is going to insist that we walk by faith. He's not going to make it a smooth and comfortable transition with overlap of paychecks, necessarily. He is going to call on you to live by faith, and sometimes he's going to dry up the situation you're in, and then and only then will he speak to you the next direction to go. Then the word of the Lord came to him, verse 8, saying, arise and go to Zarephath, because I'm an on-time God. You getting thirsty? Yeah. I was just wanting to talk to you about that. Arise and go to Zarephath, because this is done. Now I'm going to provide a different way. Oh, good. You're going to provide for me at Zarephath. Great. How far away is that? Oh, about 60 miles as a crow flies, or raven. 60 miles. Now, if he had to go up and across, it's probably closer to 80, 90, 100 miles, according to my map. So, what am I going to drink along the way? Oh, I'm going to provide for you that as well. If I sent you somewhere 60 miles away on foot, I'm going to make sure that I provide the way for you to get there. That's faith. And so, he says, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon. It's the northern Israel up on the coast, and dwell there. By the way, to get there, he had to, and this is why maps in the back of your Bible are good. Look up these places. Look up the geographical locations that are mentioned in your Bible. You learn a lot from that. He had to go from the eastern side of Israel, cross the Jordan, go up along the path there, and pass Galilee, the Sea of Galilee, the freshwater Sea of Galilee that's got lots and lots of drinking water in it, go past it to where God sent him that was many miles farther on. So you may walk along the way and say, you know, Lord, I know you told me to go up there, but you know, a great opportunity just opened up for me here. In Galilee, look, there's a lake full of water. There are people that are Jewish here. I can minister to them. There's things I could do here, Lord, don't you know? But God didn't tell him to take the easy path. God didn't tell him to minister to those people. God didn't tell him to linger where the water and the blessing was a little greater. He says, I want you to go where I told you to go. So fill up your water bottle in the Lake Sea of Galilee and move on. And so he moves on and he obeys the Lord. And in verse 9 again, he says, go to Sidon and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. Remember how he commanded the ravens and the ravens complied? Here he has commanded a widow to provide for you. Why a widow? Because a widow is the least likely to have financial capabilities of taking on another mouth. That's why. Because in those days, the provision for widows was that other family members would have to take care of them, or the begging charity of others, or they could glean the fields, kind of like some kind of form of welfare. But the problem was that the land had been barren for so long, there was no food and there was nothing to glean. So the least likely person to be able to minister to him in food and provision would be a widow. It also sounds the worst. Every time I hear an unbeliever get on TV and talk smack, some trash about some TV evangelist about, can you believe they're taking money from widows? Just like Elijah did. How would Elijah look on Dateline? How would Elijah look taking money from widows? Well, the difference is the motive of the heart. When God tells you to do something, you do something because God wanted to bless the widow, which is the answer back. No matter whether the man of the cloth is a man of God or a charlatan, if a widow obeys the Lord and gives in her offering when God says to do so, no matter what that guy's doing or how he wastes or consumes that money, God is going to bless that widow for what she did and what she gave. And so he says, I'm going to provide for you first with from the most unexpected source of ravenous ravens who are going to be selfish and not normally provide. And now I've commanded a widow there to provide for you. So he arose and he went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, indeed, a widow was there gathering sticks. Now, it's interesting, it says, was there. She was already there. God had already provided the answer for his prayers even before he got there. And God knows what you need before you ask him. And so he's already started the provision for you before you even get to it. And so she's already there. But now, here's the problem. She doesn't know that she's been commanded to deliver provision for the prophet. That's why I was wondering whether or not the ravens knew it. All she knew was God impressed her to go down and pick up sticks in a certain area. Why? Because God wanted to bless her. Now, she was probably picking up sticks, well, to make a fire. Well, she explained herself. Let's just read it. So she was already there gathering sticks, verse 10, and he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. Because God dried up my brook, and I had to walk past the Sea of Galilee, and I didn't get it day long. And by the time I'm here, 60 miles of walking, I'm thirsty, and it's a dry and thirsty land. And so he goes and sees this widow, and he says to her, please bring me a little water in a cup. Notice he said, please, right? Please, that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, because she's a nice widow woman, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand too. Oh, can I get you a lunchbox to go with it? Do you want a napkin around your neck? Do you want some sauce? Do you want some butter for the bread? Hello, I'm so poor I can barely feed myself and you're asking me, water? Okay, I think I can get some water for you. You're going to die without water, but we're all broke. Hey, hard times all around, buddy. Sorry things are bad for you. But no, She knew him to be a prophet. He was wearing the garment of a prophet. She recognized that he was a man of God. And so she felt that when she ministered to him, she was ministering to God. Now, I don't wear the robes of a prophet, so to speak. I don't go around with a clerical collar. I don't try to impress people right off the bat that I'm Pastor Steve, except in the Sunday morning service sanctuary here. Out on the street anywhere else, I'm not Pastor Steve. I'm just Steve. Why is that? Because I never want my clerical situation to be a personal blessing to me at the expense of others. But see, in that day, every teacher, every prophet would wear something that was recognizably so as a prophet or teacher, just like Jesus did. And so the woman saw who was asking, and I believe that she, instead of giving him lip, instead of mouthing off, instead of saying, "I can't, what are you kidding?" she answered him respectfully and said, "This is going to be hard." And here's what she said. "Bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink." As she was going, verse 11, he said, "Please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." So she said, verse 12, "As the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread." "I don't have it." "Only, well, you know, what do you got?" "Well, I do have this handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I'm gathering sticks right now. I'm gathering a couple of sticks," she says, "that I might go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Now, that's nothing against this widow, okay? But those are not words of faith. Don't say, "I'm going to write this last check to the mortgage company and then we're going to die." Believe that God is going to provide your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Always give with a happy heart and give as unto the Lord, believing that he's going to meet your need. Because God's not going to let you die if you're his, especially when you're sowing into his kingdom at the word of the Lord telling you to do so. And so, "I don't have anything. Just this, a couple sticks. I'm going to prepare for myself and my son. We're going to eat it, and that's it. There's nothing more. We're going to die after that. We have nothing." Now, isn't that like the most selfish, horrible thing you could do? Not only does he show up in town, not only does he ask for water and make some poor woman get up, stop what she's doing to work, and go get it for him. Like, "Hey, you got broke feet? The well's over there, you know?" Not only that, but then it's like you have to pick a widow woman. You couldn't pick like the richest guy in town who might have a little extra stashed somewhere. No, you got to pick a widow woman and you got to pick on her. Why would God allow that to happen to that poor widow woman? Why? He wanted to bless her. He wanted to bless her. Because she needed even more than everyone else. Then God wanted to bless her and show off his glory to her. He wanted to show Elijah that he was able to provide even from the most unlikely of sources, and he wanted to bless the widow along the way. And God wants to bless missionaries across the world that are spreading the gospel to others who are praying for their provision, and he wants to bless you to be the one who supplies their need. So that he gets blessed, the missionaries get blessed, and you get blessed. And so God gets glory and praise from the missionary on the field and from you back home who are willing to give. And that brings even greater glory to his name. Now, how unfair of God to expect such things. I tell you what, God does not want to carry you around. He wants you to grow up in faith. That's why I picked that video. "God, where were you at the times when it was rough? There's only one set of footprints." Well, the beautiful, and I'm not trying to diminish the original, not the video that we showed, but the original story of the two sets of footprints. He kindly and rightly says, "Those were the times where I picked you up and carried you because you were too weak." That is a beautiful and a right way to see God. But, no pun intended, if we decide that it's all about us and not about him, and we like the free ride, and we've been refreshed now, but we still want to be carried, God will drop us on our butt. and say, now I want you to stand up and walk by faith. Now I want you to stretch a little bit. And so it was that God wanted to be able to bless and help people to grow in their faith, and so caused this widow woman to be the one to supply the need. So in verse 13 it says, and Elijah said to her, do not fear. That's key. Do not fear. Go and do as you have said. But make me, yeah, go ahead. Make this, get your sticks, make some bread, and die. Go ahead, do just what you said. But before you do, make sure you tithe on it first. Now, doesn't that sound like a preacher? Have you lost your job? Well, you make sure and pay the tithes on that last paycheck now. Now, doesn't that sound like a preacher? Hopefully not this preacher, right? But how easily she could have been offended by that. How easily she could have been turned off by that kind of speaking. But that kind of speaking sometimes prompts us to be able to be and do what God has called us to do, instead of being comfortable little birds with their mouths open going, cheep, 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 cheep. Sometimes God wants us to be the early bird and get out and get the worm. And so he says, go ahead, do just what you said, but don't fear. Don't fear. Eat the bread, cook it, like you said, give some to your son, but don't fear. Don't fear, because fear is the opposite of faith. And so actually in this message, he starts with those words. Thus says the, he says, the first thing he said to her is, do not fear, because fear will eat your lunch, literally. Fear will eat your provision. Fear will keep you from walking in faith. Do what you said. Make the fire, make the bread, but don't do the dying part, is what the man of God said to her. Do what only you can do. Don't sit around and wait for welfare to drop off an airlifted package for you. Amazon's not doing, you know, little flying drones to drop you any lunch. So you're going to have to work for it. You're going to have to gather the sticks. You're going to have to start a fire with your little flint. You're going to have to blow it into a flame. You're going to have to start the cook stove. You're going to have to mix the meal. You're going to have to, you know, get that flour and make it into, you know, a bread, tortilla, whatever they did made back then. You're going to have to bake it. You're going to have to work, and you're going to have to feel the sweat of that on a hot and dry day. You're going to have to do some work. But if you do your part, God is going to meet your need. And so he says, do your part, but don't fear. Do the part that you can do, but not the fear part. Do your actions like James says, but have faith when you do it. James says, you say you have faith? Show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. So do your part, add it with faith. You'll still cook the same. It'll still be the same bread. Still going to be the same situation. The difference is you're going to be doing it without fear this time. And so he says, do not fear and do as you said, but make me a small cake from it first and bring it to me, and afterwards make some for yourself and your son. So again, there's this selfish preacher saying, you know, I want God to bless you and that's all good, but you go and make that, but give me some first, me first. Now, the prophet was told by God to say that. And so in fairness to the prophet, he wasn't being selfish at all. But he was teaching her the lesson that if you put God first, if you put God first, then blessings will come to you. But I promise you, and this is true in your own paychecks, if you put yourself first, there will almost never be anything left over for God. But if you start by giving God his due first, you will be shocked and surprised at how God takes 90% of your income and stretches it over what 100% couldn't pay for before. God promises that that's how he works. So he says, make me a cake first and then bring it to me, and afterwards for yourself and your son. It's a beautiful picture of putting God first in our giving, even when we're poor. By the way, our government graciously says to poor people, you don't have to pay taxes. Now, we all have to file taxes, you know, but poor people don't pay taxes, income tax. They end up getting a return, actually. They don't pay at least much in the way of taxes. We shift the burden of tax to the richer people. And regardless of what your politics are on that, it is a generous and gracious society that says, we want to look out for the poor and make sure that they're not overburdened. God, on the other hand, says the poor person has to give the same amount as the rich person. What? Same dollar amount? How could they? No, not the same dollar amount. The same sacrifice. 10% of a dime is a penny. 10% of $10 million is $1 million. Both the rich and the poor give equally in that they are giving proportionately. But God loves poor people more than the government does. God loves poor people enough to say, hey, poor person, I want your penny. Give me the penny. Who's got a penny? Give me the credit card. Give me your penny. What else you got? No, I'm just kidding. Give me my penny. This penny is going to do virtually nothing nowadays. I want to get rid of pennies because they cost more to produce than they're even valued at. Give me your penny as if it would do God or the government any good. But if you give your penny to God, it's like planting a seed. And what grows from that is 50 and 100 fold. God takes the widow's mite and blesses her abundantly. God took that widow's little bit from her and made great blessings happen. God loves poor people more than the government does. I'm not anti-government today. I love my government. It's good. You know, it's got problems. We all know that. Not getting into politics. Just saying, I'm not being anti-government. What I'm saying is I'm being pro-God. Because well-meaning people will let poor people continue to be poor. But God, who believes that all of us should walk by faith, wants to stretch the faith of the poor just as much as he wants to stretch the faith of the rich. And he wants the poor people to not be poor anymore. And he knows when he can weasel that penny out of that tight-fisted old widow woman and get her to invest it in the kingdom of God, he knows that he can turn on a blessing for her that nobody else could match. I'll throw your penny back, but I'm going to hurt you. Here. Oh, okay, can I keep it? No. Yeah, I'll not have it said here that I forced any offerings in this place. No, it's kidding. And so, give it to me first, verse 13. Bring it to me, and afterwards make some for yourself and your son. For thus saith the Lord. Thus saith the Lord of God of Israel. The bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. God has promised that if you give to him and put him first, that your supply will not dry up until he returns. Amen. He will take care of you. Will it always be the same way? No. Sometimes it's through the brook and the raven. Sometimes it's through the widow. Sometimes it's through good times and good jobs. Never know how the Lord's going to provide, but he's promised that if you put him first, he will always take care of you until his return. And so, he went away. She went away, verse 15, and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and her household ate for many days. Remember, she's going to have one meal, two sticks, one meal, we're dying. The bin of flour was not used up, verse 16, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. Now, many days was the provision of need. Flour was that provision that was used to provide the need many days. It didn't dry up. So God continued to provide the needs. It also says oil. And in this case, it was oil mixed with the flour was the way they made their bread, apparently, or whatever. But oil also represents something in the Holy Scriptures. It almost always represents the Holy Spirit or anointing or blessing in some form that has to do with God. And so the oil will not run dry according to the word of the Lord. That's the provision of anointing. In other words, God is not a one-time good deal. You see, when God gets involved in your blessing, sometimes you're like, things were going horrible, and we were just thought we were just going to eat our bread and die, and there was no way we were going to make it, and everybody prayed, and grandma prayed, and God did a miracle. Yay, God! I'm so glad he did, because I don't see that ever happening again. That isn't where God wants you to live. God doesn't want you to live where miracles don't ever happen again. God doesn't want it to be a one-time good deal. Sometimes we can muster enough faith to say, I have nowhere else to go. I have no one else to call on, so I guess I'll call on God. God answers the prayer. He works things out, and you say, I got it from here, God. I got it from here. I'll handle my business from now on. I'm not going to stretch myself any further because, you know, you flip a coin. Sometimes it's 50-50. Sometimes it works out. Well, God's not the God of 50-50 coin tosses. God is the God who always determines the outcome of chance. God is the one who will always provide your need again and again and again if you will continue to put him first and first and first. The oil of anointing, the oil of blessing will not run out as long as you keep putting him first. Not only for the provision of food, but for the power and anointing and presence and blessing of the Holy Spirit in your life. He's not just interested in your belly. He's interested in also helping you grow in your faith and your blessing. And so the oil did not run out. Provision of anointing is not a one-time deal. So now it happened after these things that the son of the woman who had owned the house became sick. Now, notice it says after these things, the kid got sick. He didn't get sick during these miracles. He got sick afterwards. Why is that? Because Satan hates you, and he hates for you to grow. And if he sees you start to grow and get your eyes on the provision that God has done for you, you might get happy and start praising God and telling other people. So I know I'll bring some unexpected sickness in your body, and that'll teach you. Last time I got serious with God, I got sick and lost my job, so I'm just going to go back to, you know. Don't give up on God. Don't give up on the anointing. Don't give up on the oil provision. But Satan is likely to put a big fat target on the back of your head when you start stretching yourself in faith. I'm telling you now, not to keep you from stretching your faith, but rather to tell you that when you stretch your faith, Satan is going to try to nip it in the bud. You know what I mean by nip it in the bud? If you have flowers outside out there, little buds come up, you know? If something comes along like a jackrabbit and bites the head of that thing right off, nips it in the bud will not bloom. It won't become anything because it was nipped in the bud state. And so the bud of your blessing is coming forth. The flower of God's blessing is coming forth in your life. And God and Satan sees the beginning of the growth of your belief in him as a result of the blessing of putting him first. Things are starting to grow in you. You're starting to flower. You're starting to look more beautiful than you ever were before in the spirit. You're greening up. You're freshening up. And you're starting to put out flowers of announcement that God is great. So Satan's got to nip that blessing in the bud. He wants to stop your praise before it gets out of your mouth. And so he causes things bad to happen to you to try and make a target out of you. How do you stop Satan from making a target out of you? Anybody know? Well, first you can do the frontal approach. Rebuke him. Rebuke the devil and he will flee from you. You can answer with the word of God like Jesus did, which is the number one best way to do it. Whenever Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, he used the word of the Lord to overcome Satan's every single time. The most important aspect of what Jesus did there, other than using the word of God itself, was endurance. 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 Satan will get tired of messing with you. He will go pick on someone else. That's what you want anyway, right? Can you just leave it alone? It seems like my day in the barrel. Can you just leave? Yes. Yes, that can happen. If Satan can cause problems in your life that cause you to give up on praising him and focus on the disaster, he will bring disaster after disaster after disaster after disaster in your life in a constant stream that makes you go, what happened? It's like there's one disaster after another. You ever hear anybody say stuff like that? Have you ever said that? If it ain't one thing, it's another. Why? Because you're starting to bloom, you're starting to praise, and Satan wants to nip it in the bud by bringing disaster. And as long as it keeps working, keeps you from praising, he will continue to bring disaster after disaster. The only way to overcome that is to give God praise anyway. To praise him first and receive after. To make the bread for the prophet first and then receive the continuous blessing afterward. It's by faith, folks. By faith, we begin to praise him for what he is going to do, not only for what he has already done. God, you are the God who has met my need, and you're going to continue to meet my need. And I'm getting clicked at. Why? All right. So he wants us to continue to, you got me off track. All right, sorry. That's all right. Just so I thought I was over time. Usually it's April in the front row. Click, 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 click. Time to go. But let's move on. Where were we? Verse 17. Thank you. Now it happened after these things that the son of the woman who owned the house became sick, and the sickness was so serious that there was no breath left in him. Now, when there's no breath, what does that mean? You're dead, right? So she said to Elijah, "What have I to do with you, O man of God? Have you come to bring my sin to remembrance and to kill my son?" Did he? No. James 5:14 and 15 says, "Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let him anoint him with oil, like was provided. Then anoint them with oil, and the prayer of faith will save the sick." And then the next verse says something very interesting and unusual. It says, "And if he has committed any sins, they will be forgiven." Now, we understand theologically that when you put your trust in Christ, all your sins have already been forgiven and are under the blood already. But when we sin, it always has an effect in our lives. And something begins to die. The wages of sin is always death. Thank God that my immortal soul has been saved forever, but it can cause the death of a relationship, cause the death of your income, can cause the death of your body and your health. The wages of sin is always death. And so the promise in James of, "Is anyone sick among you, let him pray," or "Let him," the elders of the church, "pray for them, anointing with oil, and if he has committed sins, they'll be forgiven," is simply a reminder that the curse of death on us sinners has been taken care of by Jesus on the cross already. And so don't worry if you think you don't deserve a blessing from God. Your sins have already been forgiven. Your sins have already been forgiven, and they are not causing you to lose a blessing now. Don't ever feel like you don't deserve God's blessing. Don't ever feel like you've sinned too much and God can't bless you. Might bless others around you, but he knows you. He knows your heart. He knows what you've done. Who does that to you? Satan, the accuser of the brethren, is quick to tell you, "You don't deserve that. Other people may not remember what you did, but I remember what you did. And I'm going to help you remember what you did." And so we feel unworthy, we feel inadequate, and we don't look to the provider. Whatever sins you've been committed, they are under the blood if you are a Christian. And they are no longer going to be able to rob you of blessing. So let's go back to 1 Kings, where it says, where she says, "Have you, O man of God, have you come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to kill my son?" Yeah, that's what I always wanted to do when I went to ministry. Yeah. And so he said to her, "Give me your son. Give me your son." "Well, Lord, he's dead." "Sure, you can have him. He's of no use to me now. You can have him. I can obey now. It's easy. He's dead." Nevertheless, it was what was required of her. Nevertheless, she obeyed. Give me your son. So he took him out of her arms and carried him into the upper room. There's got to be some significance there, where they met with the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts. Took him to the upper room where he was staying and laid him on his own bed. And when he cried out to the Lord, he said, O Lord, my God, have you also brought tragedy on the widow with whom I lodge by killing her son? The answer is no. Calamity does not come from God. God will use calamity, but he does not bring calamity on you. And so he stretched himself out over the child three times and cried out to the Lord and said, O Lord, my God, I pray, let this child's soul come back into him. So if you're wondering, was he just like close to death? Yeah, he was dead. Soul was gone, just the body. And so he prayed, let this child's soul come back into him. And the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came back to him, and he revived. So we've had the provision of food by the ravens. We've had the provision of lodging and bread and shelter with the widow. And now we've got another provision of healing by God. Healing in life. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper room into the house and gave him to his mother. And Elijah said, see, your son lives. Then the woman said to Elijah, now by this I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is the truth. Would to God that we can believe the word of God before we see it in action. Would to God that we're the ones who pray over our dead son and see him raised to life again, and not have to go to the preacher. Now you can come to the preacher, don't get me wrong. But would to God that we believe the word of the Lord before we see it revealed through someone else's faith. God taught Elijah lessons of faith throughout that story. And he shared those blessings with another generation and her child then another generation. And so we are in our generation. Are we ready to hear the challenge of the word of the Lord? Are you ready to allow God to make you uncomfortable in your surroundings in order to bring glory to himself? Are you willing to give him praise in the hard times and believe that despite hard times, he's worth praising and shout his glory ahead of time, speaking those things which are not as though they were? That's what's called being people of faith. Now, we're not done with this message, so I'm not going to have an invitation necessarily with that today. But I do want to say this in the quietness of the moment, if you just bow your head just for a moment. We're right on time. We're getting out of here. If you need Jesus to be your Savior, if you need the God of Elijah that we've read about to be one who provides life to your soul, if you need to go to heaven when you die, and you're a little worried about that, would you like to settle it this morning and call on the God of Elijah, who sent his son Jesus to die on a cross for our sins, who was buried and rose again on Easter morning? If you would like to have that God save you today and you've never done that before, would you just raise your hand quickly while no one's looking around? Let me just pray for you in our closing prayer. All right, everybody's hand is down. So that tells me some good things. Everybody's saved here. Everybody knows Jesus. So then we need to be able to go out and tell others as well. If you would like the Lord to increase your faith, and you're willing to risk the brook drying up, having to depend on others for your income, having to depend on God, and even having to chance Satan making a target out of you, and you having to praise your way through the storm, if it means a closer walk with him, is that you? And if so, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, because then you'd feel like bad if you didn't, and would I judge you and all that. I'm not going to do that. But I want you to just basically raise a hand to God. And Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that you would make us people of faith. Thank you, Lord, for this challenge from the Word of God. all the way back to Elijah's time. Thank you, Lord, for providing for that widow woman who was the least likely to be able to bless this prophet. And yet, Lord, has gone down in history and has been a hero of the faith for all of us, even up to this present day. Thank you, Lord, for teaching us to praise you for not only for what you have done for us, but also for what you're going to do for us. Teach us, Lord, to, when the brook dries up, move on and listen for your voice. Teach us to walk right on past Galilee, Lord, if it's not where you want us to be, and go to the place that you want us to be. Teach us, Lord, to not look with eyes of the natural, the flesh, to see where our next meal's coming from, where our healing's coming from, where our blessing's coming from. But help us to remember the principles of the Word of God, that if we will keep you first, that you will bless us abundantly. Help us, Lord, to be generous in our faith, generous in our blessing to others, generous into sowing into the kingdom, and then believing, Lord, that you are a faithful God who will bless abundantly, 10, 50, 100-fold in return. And Lord, when Satan tries to come and nip this in the bud and stop our praise, Lord, would you help us to be people who endure past that, so that that time will be short, so that we can continue to praise you and be, as the story ends in the next chapter, a time of refreshing when the sound of rain, the sound of abundance of rain, is just another day away. Lord, bring the rains. Bring the rains of your blessing. Bring refreshing to our nation. Bring refreshing to the land. Bring refreshing to your people, O God. But until that happens, let us be people of faith who praise you at all times and thank you ahead of time. In Jesus' name, amen.